Okay, so today we will talk about a penalty method which is for equality constraints. So last time we talked about barrier method, which is for inequality constraint problems. So now we are talking about penalty method, which is for equality constraint problems. So the topic is penalty and augmented Lagrangian method. And what we want to solve is minimize f of x. X lies in some set capital X such that h of x is equal to 0, which is the same as writing h1 of x, hm of x is equal to 0. Okay, so we have m equality constraint in this particular problem. Remember what the Lagrangian for this class of problem is, L of x comma lambda. So this is my Lagrangian. Anyone remembers what the formula for Lx lambda is? It's f of x plus lambda transpose h of x. And we knew from KKT conditions that if x is regular, x star lambda star gradient with respect to x will be equal to 0, right? And this is my gradient fx star plus lambda star transpose, well, gradient h x star transpose lambda star. Okay? What was the assumption we needed on x star? X star needs to be regular, which means that this gradient of h x star has to be a full rank matrix. And for your recap, gradient of h x star is equal to gradient of h1 x star, gradient of h2 x star, gradient of hm x star. Okay, so this is my gradient of h, and it has to be full rank. What does that mean? These vectors have to be linearly independent. So this is what we get from KKT conditions. So now the question is, how do we solve a problem of this type? So there are two ideas. One idea is pick lambda close to lambda star, and find local minimum of, I haven't given you what the expression for augmented Lagrangian is, of LC x comma lambda, where augmented Lagrangian LC of x comma lambda is given by f of x plus lambda transpose h of x. Plus c over 2 norm of h of x square. Okay, that's idea number one. Okay. In many cases, the set X is going to be Rn. So all you have to do is find a local minimum of unconstrained. So this will become an unconstrained local minimum. Okay. If X was Rn, and in many problems you will have X in Rn. Okay. So all you have to do is find an unconstrained local minimum of LC of X lambda. Well, how do you find an unconstrained local minimum of this? You use Newton's method, you use gradient descent, you use whatever, you know, lots of methods that we have studied. So this is how you define an augmented Lagrangian. So you put a penalty term for violating the constraint. This is the usual Lagrangian terms, right? Fx plus lambda transpose h of x. And if you find a local minimum of this function, a local minimum in the unconstrained space. Okay, so these constraints are no longer, I don't want to say these constraints are no longer valid. These constraints, it just so turns out that if your C is sufficiently large and if your lambda is close to lambda star, then the unconstrained local minimum of LC would satisfy these constraints. Okay, so you will get a feasible solution. In the even though what I'm saying, even though you're solving an unconstrained problem, if C is sufficiently large, the unconstrained solution to this minimization problem will satisfy these conditions. Okay, so you're getting a feasible solution by solving an unconstrained optimization problem. So that's one idea. Okay. The second idea is you pick C very large, and hope that argument LC X lambda X in X will be a feasible point and solve for this optimization problem. Okay, and I want to point out the differences between these two methods. In this method, you assume that lambda is close to lambda star and you pick C sufficiently large. In this method, you have to pick C very, very large. Okay, 10 raised to 6, 10 raised to, I don't know, whatever, 5. Okay, so there is a very, very high penalty for violating the constraint. Now, if you solve this minimization problem, the optimal solution will satisfy these constraints. And if it satisfies those constraints, then we will hope that it will be a local minimum of the original problem. Okay, so this is the better method. Okay, than this one. But we will see how can we use these ideas to solve the problem. So any question about these two ideas? Okay, we have two ideas. One is where lambda is close to lambda star. C is sufficiently large, it doesn't have to be very high. The second option is pick C very, very high and then solve this minimization problem. Now, when we are working according to these ideas, it might just turn out that this doesn't have a solution, okay? In which case, you probably won't be able to find a solution to this kind of problem, okay? So you come up with a very specific problem with a very specific set of constraints, and then you put it in the augmented Lagrangian framework, and you see that, well, it doesn't have a local minimum, right? So you apply the gradient descent, and it goes to infinity, okay? So in which case it might be possible that this problem doesn't have a solution to begin with. Okay, so there's no algorithm that can find the solution because there's no solution to this problem. The other problem could occur if your x star was not regular, which means the gradient of h at x star is not a set of linearly independent vectors, which means you have some redundant constraints that you have not removed from your optimization problem. Okay, so remove the redundant constraints. So that would help you solve this problem. Okay, so now I'm going to assume that you have removed redundant constraints, you have a feasible solution in the space, so that way these methods are bound to work in almost all circumstances. Okay. So the first method I want to talk about is known as quadratic penalty method. Okay, and let me erase these. And the idea is, at step k, find argmin xk equals argmin of x in x l ck x lambda k. Okay, so what are we doing? At every point of time, we pick a value of lambda k, we pick a value of ck, we run gradient descent or Newton's method or whatever your favorite method is. You use that method to compute x of k, and then you increase the value of ck, you increase or change the value of lambda k, or even keep the value of lambda k constant. Okay. You can do that and then use xk as the starting point for the next round of Newton's method or next round of gradient descent to find xk plus 1. Okay, does that make sense? Okay, so we start. So this is my space, capital X. Okay, I pick a value of c1 and lambda 1 and I find x1. Okay, I started with some x0, and then I ran Newton's method. I reached x1, okay, and then I changed the value of, so I changed c2, I picked the value of c2, which is strictly larger than c1, so c2 is strictly larger than c1, and I pick another value of lambda k, and we will get to it, how do you pick a value of lambda k, but we'll pick another value of lambda k, or we'll update lambda k according to some rule, or we might just keep the lambda k constant. Okay, and then we run another set of gradient descent, okay, to reach x2, and then we reach x3 and so on. Okay, and as we increase, my ck will go to infinity. Okay, so I'm monotonically increasing the value of cks. So c1 is less than c2, c2 is less than c3, c3 is less than c4. And my ck goes all the way to infinity. So eventually, I'm going to converge to the optimal point x star. So that's the idea here. Why do we call it a quadratic penalty? Because remember, in the expression for augmented Lagrangian, you put a quadratic penalty on the violation of constraint. Right? So my LC equals f plus lambda transpose h plus c over 2. Norm of h square. So this is the quadratic penalty term that's mentioned here. Okay, any question about this method? Yes, yes. So these class of algorithms, you can think of it as having two time scales. One is the longer time scale in which you update k. And one is the shorter time scale where you run the Newton's method or gradient descent. Okay, so essentially you have x 1 l, then x 2 l, then x 3 l, and so on. Okay, so this l will keep track of how many Newton's iterations you have taken or how many gradient descent iterations you have taken. And if your x was R n, which is usually the case, then you are essentially solving an unconstrained minimization problem. If X was a convex set, then you have to apply some of those conditional gradient method or other methods that we have studied for solving a optimization problem over a convex set. Okay? Yes, Tyler.
You want C to go to infinity fast?
There is a trade-off. If you allow C to go to infinity very fast, then your algorithm will not work as well. So the usual way to pick CK plus 1 is CK plus 1 is equal to beta multiplied by CK, where beta is in 4/10. Okay? So you don't want it to be too fast, escaping to infinity too fast. Any other question? Okay, so what's the main result here? What's the proposition? The proposition is I want my X to be closed. So if X was equal to Rn, it is by definition both open and closed. I want my set X in X such that H of X is equal to 0 to be closed. Because if my iterates terminate, it has to be within the set. I don't want it to go outside the set. So we want that to be closed and non-empty. I want my CK to go to infinity. So this sign is CK converges to infinity, but it's always monotonically increasing. And I want my lambda K to converge to some lambda bar. So I pick a value of lambda K that converges to some value lambda bar. Okay? You could also keep lambda K constant, and so it, by definition, a constant sequence converges to a limit. And then the result is if xk converges to x bar, then x bar is the global minimum. Okay? Global minimum of this optimization problem. Okay. X is closed. Yes, fine. I mean, I understand that assumption. This should be non-empty and closed. Well, I understand that assumption as well, because if H is continuous, it's by definition closed, right? And it should be non-empty, so it should not be like. So when can be it non-empty? Let's say you have a constraint x1 plus x2 equals to 1 and 2x1 plus 2x2 equals to 3. Okay? If you have this constraint, what is this? Empty set, right? There's no x that satisfies these two conditions simultaneously. It's also a case where the gradient of h1 and gradient of h2, they are linearly dependent, right? So it's not a regular. I mean, even if it was a non-empty set, there is a redundant constraint here, and so you need to remove that constraint. Okay. Now, you might think that it's foolish to assume to have these conditions because we will never encounter them in reality. But let's say you are working in MATLAB and you're writing a minimization software for some toolbox. You have to check for these conditions, okay? And then you have to throw an error to the user that, well, your constraints are redundant, or well, your constraints don't make sense, or there is no feasible point, and so on. Okay? So these conditions are important, okay? Especially when you are writing a routine that will be used by users, because users can give whatever input they want. Okay? You are supposed to throw an error and say that, well, I can't do anything because your problem doesn't make sense to me. Okay, does that make sense? Okay, so this is non-empty. We understand why it should be non-empty. And then the only two extra assumptions here that we don't understand well so far is that CK should go to infinity, but well, we know why it should go to infinity, because we want to penalize the not conforming to the constraint. Okay, so that's good point. And lambda k converges to lambda bar. So lambda k should have a convergent, it should be a convergent sequence. And typically, I would just take lambda k to be constant. Okay. Then if xk converges to x bar, if your algorithm converges, then you're guaranteed that x bar is the global minimum. Okay. Why is it a global minimum? Because you are doing the argument here. If it was not really a convex function and you could not find a global minimum, then I would change this global minimum to local minimum. Okay. Does that make sense? Oh, so you see, when I write argmin of x in x, I'm saying that you have to find the global minimum of this function. Okay? But let's say this function was non-convex, so all you can find is a local minimum. So then this will be arg local minimum of x in x, and then I'll have to change it to local minimum. Okay. Okay. Now let's say you're applying Newton's method or gradient descent to solve this problem, this argument problem at step k. Are you going to compute xk, or are you going to terminate before you reach xk? Okay, you will probably terminate when the gradient of LCK with respect to x is very small. Okay, 10 raised to minus 5, 10 raised to minus 6. So what happens if you stop at that point? What kind of result can we show? So here is the next result. So the next result is for inexact minimization, where xk is approximately equal to argmin of x in x, LCK, blah, blah, blah. So the proposition is, let's say my x was equal to Rn. I am terminating, so I'm making sure that xk is close to the argmin. So I'm essentially terminating algorithm whenever the gradient of the augmented Lagrangian is less than epsilon, or the norm of the gradient is less than epsilon, or epsilon k, my ck goes to infinity and my epsilon k goes to zero. Okay, these are not the only conditions. Okay, I have to write some more conditions. My xk converges to x bar, and gradient of h x bar is full rank. Okay, then my lambda k plus ck h x k converges to lambda star. Okay. How does this help us? So what is the setting here? So let's understand the setting first. My x is Rn, I understand. Well, I have to compute xk, which is equal to argmin, but I'm not that patient, okay? I don't want to go all the way to infinite iteration, so I'm going to stop it at some point of time. Whenever the gradient of this unconstrained minimization, or rather the gradient of the augmented Lagrangian is strictly less than epsilon k, my epsilon k goes to zero, my ck goes all the way to infinity. These are the terms I already understand. And my xk converges to x bar, okay? And I know that the gradient of hx bar is full rank, okay? So I've removed all possible redundant constraints. So my gradient of h is a full rank matrix. Then it turns out that lambda k plus ck hxk, this is a sum that we all understand. I mean, nothing unusual about it. But what is unusual here is that this term would converge to lambda star. Okay. So what this tells us is when we are running this algorithm and when we are picking lambda k, we might as well pick lambda k plus 1 as lambda k plus ck hxk, right? Because we know that if my iteration converges and this is full rank, then it would converge to lambda star. Okay, so if I update my lambda k according to this fashion, I might be getting closer to lambda star, and we will be able to find lambda star as well as x star in the limit. Okay, so when you update your lambda k in this way, it's known as method of multipliers. Okay. So what do we have now? We start with some initial condition x naught, which is in this set, x. I pick a value of c naught, 1, 2, 5, 20, 100, whatever. Lambda naught, some arbitrary number. And I compute this argmin. I have the option of keeping lambda k as constant and just increasing ck, or I can also update lambda k according to this fashion. And then pick a new value of ck. Let's say c1 was equal to 10 multiplied by c0. So if you started with c0 equals 100, then c1 will be 1,000. And then you minimize L of 1,000 x comma lambda 1, where lambda 1 could either come from this expression, or you could just take lambda 1 equals lambda naught. And you can solve it. You can terminate it before it reaches the local or global minimum, right? And you can keep updating it as long as your epsilon k goes to zero, your algorithm will most likely converge. And if it converges, then you are guaranteed that it's a global minimum or a local minimum. Okay? So that's the basic idea of this augmented Lagrangian method. The cool thing here is that you have transformed a constrained optimization problem to an unconstrained optimization problem. Okay? If your x was equal to Rn, it's an unconstrained optimization problem. If your x was all values of non-negative x, okay, you can use some of the methods. Remember one method that I had mentioned where you could solve an optimization problem for x greater than or equal to 0. What was that method called? I forgot the name of the method. That's too bad. I should remember the names of the method. Okay. Anyone remembers what the name of the method was? Two metric projection method. Okay. So if your x was x greater than or equal to 0, you could use two metric projection method. Okay, we did this in the class a few weeks back. So So you can essentially solve this problem much more easily than trying to work with several equality constraints, all of which could be highly nonlinear constraints. Okay. Any questions so far? So now, how do we take care of inequality constraint problems with this kind of within this setup? Let's learn that. Inequality constraint problem. So my problem is minimize fx, x is in x, h of x equals to 0, g of x is less than equal to 0. Okay. How do I transform it into a problem that looks like this? Any thoughts?
Always.
Sorry?
Like always a slack variable.
Slack variables? That's a good idea. We should give it a shot. H of x equals to 0, g of x plus u equals to 0. What constraint should I add on u? U has to be greater than or equal to 0. Okay, u is known as slack variable, as you might recall. Slack variable. Okay, and let's say for the time being that my x was, my x is equals to Rn, and my g is a function from Rn to R. Okay? By looking at this problem, which has equality constraint, what have I done? Any thoughts? What have I done? I have a problem, an optimization problem, in n-dimensional space. I have transformed it into an optimization problem over n plus r dimensional space, right? So this is n plus r dimensional optimization problem. Okay, and this is n-dimensional optimization problem. Okay, so this is a very important trick in optimization, where you have a low dimensional optimization problem, but solving it is hard. So what you do is you lift it into a very high dimensional optimization problem, and then solving it becomes easier. Okay, and the reason why it becomes easier is because then you can apply methods of this type. If you wanted to solve it in this space, what would you do? You would use barrier method. Okay, so you would use barrier method if you wanted to solve it in this space. Somehow you will have to take care of the equality constraint. I don't know how you will take care of it, but you have to use barrier method to solve this problem if you wanted to solve it in the original space. But now, because it's a n plus r dimensional optimization problem, you can use augmented Lagrangian method or penalty method. Okay, and depending upon the structure of the problem, one might be easier than the other. So that's the That's a nice thing, okay? You can keep moving around the spaces just to make your life easier, okay? Of course, how do you move around spaces? That requires a lot of hard work, okay? But once you know it, then your life is easy.
So it becomes easier because it, you're turning it into unconstrained?
Yes. So it depends on multiple factors. One of it could be the barrier method does not seem to converge if you apply it. But then you apply the penalty method and it seems to converge. So there is no general rule that barrier method is better or penalty method is better. It just depends on what the speed of convergence is, how well the algorithm responds to whatever algorithm you're using, how well the optimization problem responds to what your algorithm is, okay, and so on. Okay? So no general guideline. All I'm saying is, if barrier method doesn't work, lift the problem into higher dimensional space, apply the penalty method, it might work. Okay, so let's see what this optimization problem becomes in this space. So let me write the augmented Lagrangian. I'm going to delete this. X, comma, U, comma, lambda, comma, mu equals to F of X plus lambda transpose H of X plus mu transpose G of X plus U plus C over 2 norm of HX square plus C over 2 norm of gx plus u square. And what's my set x? And I want to mention what my set, let me call this set y. X comma u such that x is in x and u is greater than or equal to 0, u in RR. Okay, so now I am solving this problem. Let me. This is equal to y x u. So what I have to do is find minimum of LC of x. Remember, what I have to do is minimize over x in x and u greater than equal to 0 of x u lambda mu. Okay, how would I do this minimization? So I'm going to split this big minimization problem into two minimization problems. So the first minimization will be with respect to x. The second minimization will be with respect to u greater than or equal to 0 of LC XU lambda mu. Okay? And we will concentrate on this optimization problem. Okay, so what is this trick? Well, there is no trick here. I have minimization with respect to two independent variables. I can always split this minimization problem into two separate minimization problems where I minimize with respect to one variable first and then minimize with respect to second variable. Or rather, I should say minimize with respect to the first variable here and then minimize with respect to the second variable. Okay, it's a fairly standard trick. So minimum with respect to x1 and x2 is same as minimum with respect to x1 and minimum with respect to x2. Okay, that's what I'm using here. Is this clear to everyone? Any question? Yes.
Can you do it in the opposite order?
Yes, you can do it in the opposite order. You can do it this way too. Okay, doesn't matter which way you are minimizing. These two should be independent, okay? What I mean is x2 cannot be a function of x1 and x1 cannot be a function of x2. They have to be independent of each other, which is the case here. U is greater than or equal to 0, doesn't depend on x. X lies in the set x, doesn't depend on u. So we can solve this minimization problem. So this doesn't depend on u, this doesn't depend on u, this depends on u. Doesn't depend on you, this depends on you. So all I have to do is figure out minimum of u greater than or equal to 0 of mu transpose g of x plus u plus C over 2 norm of gx plus u square. Okay? So other terms do not depend on u, so I can drop them from this minimization problem. Let's look at it more closely, and let's look at this inequality more closely. So I want u1 greater than or equal to 0, ur greater than or equal to 0. Of summation mu I or mu j gj of x plus uj plus c over 2 gj of x plus uj square. And this summation is with respect to j equals 1 to r. Okay, so I expanded this expression in the form of summation. And now what do I notice? What's the noticeable thing here? Well, this is minimization with respect to r independent variables. And each term depends on one of these variables, right? So I can split this minimization problem as a sum of j minimization problem. So this is the same as summation j equal, well, let me write it on the other side. Okay, so now I have, this is equal to summation j equals 1 to r min with respect to uj greater than or equal to 0, mu j gj x plus uj plus c over 2 gj x plus uj square. Okay, so is this clear? Why we went from here to here? We have a sum of. So what's the theory that we are using here to go from this summation, this minimization of summation to sum over minimization. This is not always true. Okay, this is not always true, but I can do it in this case. Why? Okay, so here is the simple expression. Let's say I have minimum with respect to x1 and x2 of f x1, f1 x1 plus f2 x2. What I'm doing is I have this function, which is a function of x1 and x2, because but they are separable. Okay, they are separable. There is a function of x alone, and there is a function of x1 alone, and then there is a function of x2 alone. So I can write it as minimization with respect to f1, f1, x1, plus minimization with respect to x2, f2, x2. Okay, I can always do that. And the sum of minimization is equal to the minimization of the sum. Okay, this is minimization of the sum. This is sum of minimization. Because the function is separable, I can do that. Okay, the variables are independent, the function is separable. I can do the sum of minimization as minimization of the sum. They both are equal. So that's what I'm doing, going from here to here. Any question? Okay. Now, if you do the minimization, which is part of your assignment, so you will have to do it, it turns out that it is equal to a very bad looking expression, which is 1 over 2c max of 0 mu j plus gj of x square mu j plus c gj of x square minus mu j square. Okay, this is a continuous function. This is a continuous function in x, and then you can substitute it in the expression for the augmented Lagrangian. So what you will have is min over u greater than equal to 0 LC is equal to f of x plus lambda transpose h of x plus c over 2 norm of h of x square plus this summation j equals 1 to r 1 over 2c and then this expression. Okay, and then what you have to, so this is purely a function of x, u doesn't participate in this, so then you can run your gradient descent or whatever your favorite algorithm is to solve this problem, solve this minimization problem. Okay, so what's the crux of this entire class or in this entire lecture? We had this equality constraint problem. We said that, well, we have to find an algorithmic method so that we satisfy this equality constraint in the limit. So what do? We come up with an unconstrained problem where we are trying to minimize the augmented Lagrangian. Okay, and we take the penalty term, go to infinity, and it so turns out that if we do the math, if my algorithm converges to a limit, the limit will be in the feasible set, it will satisfy all the constraints, and it will be a local minimum of the original function. Okay, and we saw how to update lambda k, we saw how to update ck, and so on. Okay, so that part was done. And then we said, well, what if we have an inequality constraint problem? So then the idea is, if you have inequality constraint problem, then we can't apply the penalty method as it is. Okay, so we introduce slack variable, which means lifting a low dimensional problem to a high dimensional problem. We use slack variables to lift the problem into higher dimension, so everything became equality constraint problem. Then we defined the augmented Lagrangian, where you have both the variables. Okay, you are doing minimization with respect to both the variables. So I'm going to split it, do the math, some simple math, okay, and I'm going to concentrate on this term. And in the end, what I get is this expression, which is purely a function of x. So this is only a function of x. Okay, so this entire term is a function of x only. Now I can use gradient descent or whatever other favorite method I have to solve this minimization problem, minimization of x and x. Okay, and then I can minimize with respect to x in this problem, change the value of ck appropriately, change the value of lambda k and mu k's appropriately, and in the limit, we will have the solution that not only satisfies the constraint, but is provably locally optimal or globally optimal of the original optimization problem. Okay? So that's what we did in this class. So if you have to lift your problem into high dimension, don't be afraid. Okay, it might just be the next best thing you have done in your life. Okay, so don't be afraid. Lift the optimization problem into higher dimension space and then try to solve it in that high dimension space. It might be much easier to solve. Okay, so that's it for today. We'll look at a few examples in the next class. Oh, by the way, I have graded assignment 2. Any of you?